Chosen deacon in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
You can pray with me. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill the hearts of these your faithful, and kindle within them the fire of your love, and may my words and our hearts together glorify you, O God, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
Amen. I want to first give thanks to God for this moment, this mystery of God present. The mystery of Jesus Christ, who consecrates this moment with his life. And to the mystery of the Holy Spirit who moves among us and between us and within us, without us and beyond us. I want to thank all of you who are here faithfully on this evening, this holy evening. It's an honor to be with you and worship our God with you in this special service of ordination. And thank you, Chris, for the opportunity to stand in this pulpit and preach this evening, for your friendship and collegiality. You are in this moment. You are in this moment at an ending and a beginning. You are at the end of a long journey, and you have persevered in the faith. And yet, in this same moment, you are at this beginning, this place where you take on the mantle of ministry. And I know it's not lost on you what a holy moment this is. And I want to say to you what I think all of these people would say to you right now. I am confident that God has brought you to this place. And I'm even more confident that God will be with you on this journey, this new beginning that you now step into. Well, I was raised United Methodist here in Texas. And I found my way to the United Church of Christ. And here in this beautiful sanctuary, with this amazing music and this beautiful liturgy, it's not lost on me that the Episcopal Church has done well at preserving the focus on worship and liturgy and the scripture. And so I want to say a brief word about the scriptures this evening, these scriptures selected. And I want to tie them to this moment and to your ministry. As I read and listen to the word coming to us through the story of the prophet Jeremiah, I couldn't help but think about the fact that this story is not just Jeremiah's story. And it was and remains his story, but it is your story. It is a story we all want to hear about God knowing us and knitting us together, and knowing us by name and calling us forth. In fact, isn't it true that God knit us together in the womb and consecrated us as children of God and called us by our lives and our name, Christian, to be prophets to the nation? Speaking to God on behalf of the people and speaking to the people on behalf of God. And now, more than ever, this world needs people to speak. Now, more than ever, while creation groans under what we have done, while our nation tears apart at the seams because we can't talk to each other and can't stay in the same room hardly, we need people to speak and say the prophetic hard things. And I know that it would be easier to say, not me, I'm new at this. I'm just starting. But Chris, you are called to preach the word, no matter how hard it is for us to hear. And if you do this, if you risk this word, then the promise of God is that God will put God's word in your mouth and on your lips. That's the promise. And that promise is not just for preachers. That promise is for all of the faithful. In reading from the Acts of the Apostles, we hear the focus turn to the community. And we would be neglecting things if we didn't talk about the fact of community and how important it is. And sometimes I think we get caught up in our individual personal journeys of faith, and we forget that we are part of this great thing called the body of Christ, and we are called to be in community. And the community does its best when people are doing the things they're most called to. And some people are called to devotion, and some people are called to service. And yet it takes all of that body, all of that community. There is an admonition right at the beginning of that passage. It says to not neglect the word of God. And I had the blessing several times of hearing that great disciple preacher, Fred Craddock, speaking. And I remember one day I was sitting right on the front row because he was always got there early so I could sit right up close to him, you know. And he said, you know, if you really want to truly be a good preacher, love the text. Love the text. If you really want to be faithful, love the text. I would say that if we really want to be faithful and be a good community, we will love the text. And you are called to love the text. Year after year after year. Because there's going to be an Easter. When you step up into that pulpit, you think, I am certain I have nothing new to say. That's when you trust in the Lord to put the word in your mouth. And, of course, the promise of that passage is that by being community, by taking our various roles, by being the body, the word will spread. And that's a little hard to believe today, isn't it? Because I just came back from the trustees meeting of Eden Theological Seminary where we looked at all the stats of people leaving the church. And of course, all us mainliners know that that's been happening for a long time. It's the evangelicals who are all scared because they're just figuring that out, right? But it's serious. The number of people going to seminary, the number of people being ordained has dropped so dramatically. And so there's times when I think we think the word's not going to spread. But God calls us to be faithful, even now. And finally, a caution from the gospel, as you might imagine. The gospel tells us that they began to argue over who was the greatest, obviously missing the greatness sitting in their midst, obviously missing the greatness of God's presence among them, obviously missing the greatness of the Holy Spirit within them. But greatness, according to Jesus, is not about wealth or power or lording our lives over another. Chris, this will always be the challenge. It will challenge you the rest of your ministry because we live in a culture that values power and wealth and lording it over others. And so you will need to count on these people and these friends in ministry and your faithful devotion to your relationship with God and with the text to remember that Jesus said that's not the way. Always checking and balancing your living. Are you serving? Are you truly reflecting the likeness of Jesus in your ministry? I just came from that meeting this morning in St. Louis, Missouri, and two things I heard there, besides all the stats. And you know, stats are interesting because we kind of live in that world of the intellect and stats, and they're interesting, but this has never been the world the Holy Spirit operates in, or that God operates in, or that Jesus operated in. And so I think we have to listen carefully for the things that are true. Two things happen there, and I believe I want you to hear them this evening. In this moment, when you take on this mantle of ministry, the first was that collectively, our trustees of the seminary acknowledged that we live in a very different world today than the world in which most of us were ordained. A very different world from the time you began this journey, Chris. It is changing rapidly. And it moves at a fast pace. I mean, there weren't even smartphones when I graduated, and the social media revolution was not even a sparkle in Mark Zuckerberg's eye. And yet it has transformed and changed everything. So two things I would say to you about this world that you are stepping into in which to do ministry. First, this is not to say that we throw over everything to what is new. God is always doing a new thing, but we have to have our grounding in those who came before us, which I think the Episcopal Church does so very well. In fact, if we're honest, there are people today who are hungry for this. They are hungry for that music. They are hungry for this word. They are hungry for the feast that tells them that their lives matter. And your great challenge in all of this will be to bring hope through this ancient faith, to navigate it, however, in the rapidly changing waters of our culture, and to find ways to engage those who most need to hear this, that they are loved. And that will be hard to do. It will be hard to find them. And yet it is essential. Not for the life of the church, and not to save the church, but to save their hearts. The second thing I heard at this meeting was in the chapel service, in which the preacher outlined all the problems that we are facing. He talked about Las Vegas and the hurricanes I don't have to delineate them for you. And here we were in St. Louis, where the cauldron of racism is just brewing so violently. It would be incumbent upon you to step into these things and yet to ground yourself in the dwelling place of the Lord, to long for and faint for the courts of the Lord, so that you hear and your flesh will be able to sing for joy the Lord's song for those who have forgotten how to sing, who have lost all hope. Some of the most important things you will do have nothing to do with vestries and meetings and councils and buildings. And yet, so often we think that's what's really important. I came down the steps of the Cathedral of Hope one day to get ready to go into worship, and I thought, oh my God, we're going to have to change this carpet. And I thought, oh, what has happened to me? Instead, the most important work you will do will be to remind people of their hope. It will be incumbent upon you to live and minister in such a way that when you go home, the people of your congregation will say, I am loved. It will be important for you that the worship you lead is so intellectually challenging and so spiritually alive that those who come to the table of God's grace will hear the words they most need to hear in the world. I forgive you. I love you. Come to supper. And for you, Chris, one last thing. I'm sure is scriptural, but not in this evening's text, but I'm going to say it anyway. Chris worked at the Cathedral of Hope. We worked together, and he, for a brief moment, explored ministry in the United Church of Christ. But one day I was sitting on the chancel, he was leading worship, and I looked over at him, and God let the scales fall from my eyes, and I thought, oh, the Episcopalian is seeping out of his pores. This man has got to be an Episcopalian priest. And so the next day when we met, I told him that. And so with all the awe and wonder that you come to lead worship, with all the seriousness, and I hope you will never lose that because it is so important that you recognize what is the holy thing that is happening every time these good people gather. It is also important that you laugh, that you truly celebrate God's presence, and that you aren't afraid to laugh at yourself and with others, and that the joy of the Lord is shown in you. And our world needs joy right now. And then here's the truth, the real truth. Not you, not me, none of us have half a chance of making all this work. Oh, it's not that the days are too difficult. Jeremiah didn't have it so good. The disciples, well, you know how it turned out for all of them. It's just that we are hopeless without this Lord. This Lord who loves us. We heard, how lovely is thy dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. That psalm ends with these words. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. God bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. The joy of the Lord, Chris. In this moment, in all of your moments ahead, trust in the Lord who is your sun and your shield. And then watch the unimaginable happen. In the name of God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.